Further on this question, constitutional mechanisms to resolve interstate river water disputes have failed to address and solve the problems. Constitutional mechanisms to resolve interstate river water disputes have failed to address and solve the problems. Please stop. Is the failure due to structural or process inadequacy? Is the failure due to structural or process inadequacy or both? Discuss. Constitutional mechanisms to resolve interstate river water disputes have failed to address and solve the problems. Is the failure due to structural or process inadequacy or both? For example, if you take a river Kaveri river water dispute, it was referred to the tribunal in 1986 to 1996, 2006, 2016. Even today, the issue is not yet resolved. It continues to be a dispute between Karnataka and the state of Tamil Nadu. So it took almost more than 2 decades. That is the first part of the question. The existing mechanisms to resolve the interstate river water disputes have failed to solve the problem of interstate river water disputes. Is the failure due to structural inadequacy or process inadequacy or both? What do you mean by structural inadequacy? So for both of you are beginners, but this topic is generalist topic. Maybe in the next class I will start with basics. So even if there is some difficulty, try to cope. What do you mean by structural inadequacy? What do you mean by structural inadequacy and the procedural inadequacy? See, structural inadequacy refers to the existing provisions in the Indian Constitution. Were they adequate or they are inadequate? And similarly, the legislative framework, the existing legislative framework for resolving the interstate river water disputes. For example, in India under the Indian Constitution, we have Article 262. And similarly, we have Article 136. Then we have National Water Resources Council. Then under Article 262, we have enacted a legislation called Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. So first we will try to discuss the constitutional provisions relating to interstate river water disputes. What about the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution? What does the 7th schedule specify? Yeah. So 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution defines the distribution of powers between the central government and the state government, union parliament and the state legislature. So with respect to interstate river water disputes, what are the entries in the union list, what are the entries in the state list and what they speak about? For example, if you take 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution, 7th schedule, list 1, what is list 1? Union list. List 2, what is list 2? State list. In the union list as of now we have around 100 items. The 56th item in the union list deals with the interstate river waters. Then in the state list, how many items we have in the state list now? 61 items. The original Indian Constitution contained 66 items. In 1976, the 42nd Amendment to the Indian Constitution, made by Indira Gandhi government, transferred 5 items from the state list to concurrent list. So relating to wildlife, weights and measures, population policy, and then education, administration of courts other than the Supreme Court and High Court. So these are the 5 subjects originally in the state list, moved to the concurrent list in 1976 in the 42nd Amendment Act. As of now, the state list contains 61 items. And out of these 61 items, entry 17 deals with water. Water. So in other words, the subject of water is there both in the state list as well as in the union list. In the union list it is under entry 56, in the state list it is under entry 17. Then what is the difference? See, an interstate river, what do you mean by an interstate river? A river which flows through more than one state. A river which flows through more than one state, it is called interstate river. So usually the legislative jurisdiction of a particular state legislative assembly will not extend beyond the boundary of the state. So that's why with respect to developing the waters of interstate rivers, the power is given to the parliament, and that was included in entry 56. So the interstate river water and the river valleys, this is a subject in the union list, which means the union government has got authority, the union parliament has got authority. And all the remaining issues relating to water, they are in the state list, entry 17. That is the supply of drinking water, canal irrigation, distribution of water, generation of electricity, all these items relating to water, they are in the state list, entry 17. In addition to this, Article 262 very clearly says that Parliament may by law provide for adjudication of interstate river water disputes. Adjudicate means resolve the dispute. Under Article 262, it has got two clauses, Clause 1, Article 262, Clause 2. Under Article 262, Clause 1, Article 262, Clause 1 says that Parliament may by law provide for adjudication of interstate river water disputes. Adjudication means resolving the interstate river water disputes. Parliament may by law. So that's why in 1956 this is the law enacted under Article 262 plus 1. Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 was the law enacted by the Indian Parliament under Article 262 plus 1. Article 262 plus 1 gives power to the Indian Parliament, not to the Supreme Court of India. And here you can make a comparison with the American Constitution. Under the American Constitution, even in America there are around 50 states. Even in America there are interstate rivers. But in America, an interstate river water dispute is referred to the American Supreme Court, straight away. So the American Constitution has provided for judicial solution to the interstate river water dispute. Why do we say that it is judicial solution? Because the matter is referred to the American Supreme Court and the American Parliament does not have any power. But the framers of the Indian Constitution provided for political solution. Why do we say that it is a political solution? Because the power is given to Indian Parliament. Indian Parliament represents the people of this country. So Parliament, by enacting a legislation, can provide a mechanism for resolving the interstate river water disputes. So in India, the power to resolve the interstate river water disputes was given to the Parliament. In America, the power to resolve the interstate river water disputes is given to the American Supreme Court. So the American Constitution provided for judicial solution, Indian Constitution provided for political solution. And this is the law enacted by the Indian Parliament. Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 was the law enacted by the Indian Parliament under Article 262 plus 1. So this legislation provides for constituting tribunals to resolve the interstate river water dispute. And usually the tribunal will be constituted by the Chief Justice of India. And a tribunal will contain three members, one chairman and two other members. Usually the chairman of the tribunal will be a judge of Supreme Court. A judge of Supreme Court will act as the chairman of the tribunal. The remaining two members, they could be judges of the Supreme Court or judges of the High Court. And the mechanism is the tribunal. So if there is a dispute with respect to a river water flowing through more than one state, the matter will be referred to the tribunal. And what is the composition of the tribunal, how the tribunal should function, this was all discussed in detail in the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. That is Article 262 Clause 1. Then what is Article 262 Clause 2? Article 262 Clause 2. See, Article 262 Clause 2 says that Parliament may by law exclude the jurisdiction of courts relating to interstate river water disputes. That means An interstate river water dispute has to be referred to the tribunal under the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. It cannot be taken before the High Court and Supreme Court. But isn't that we are not taking the river water disputes to the Supreme Court of India? We are taking them. Routinely the matters go to the Supreme Court of India. But Article 262 Clause 3 expressly prohibits. But how the matters are taken to the Supreme Court of India? Article 262 says Parliament by law has to provide a mechanism for interstate river water disputes. And the mechanism provided is a tribunal. Interstate river water dispute has to be referred to the tribunal. The tribunal will give the award and that has to be implemented by the state government. There the matter should end. But the matter doesn't end there. The award of the tribunal is again challenged before the Supreme Court of India. But Article 262 Clause 2 very clearly says no court shall be allowed to entertain the disputes relating to interstate river water disputes. Then how the matter is taken to the Supreme Court of India? Article 262 very clearly says the interstate river water dispute should not go before the courts. But how the matters are taken? For example, Kaveri between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, it's pending with the Supreme Court of India. And how the matter is taken to the Supreme Court of India? There is one article called Article 136. Article 136. What is this Article 136? Have you heard about special leave petition? Special leave petition. So this was an extraordinary power available to the Indian Supreme Court. It's not available even to the American Supreme Court. What do you mean by special leave petition? Special leave means permission. Special leave petition means a petition filed before the Supreme Court of India asking the Supreme Court to give permission to take up cases. For example, in India we have a hierarchy of courts. Supreme Court, High Court, Lower Courts. Lower Courts. So under Article 136, the Supreme Court can take before itself any case decided by any court anywhere in the country. Similarly, the Supreme Court can take before itself any case decided by any tribunal anywhere in the country. So we say that it is an overriding power. Overriding power in the sense, if the citizens of this country don't feel that justice is done to them in the lower courts, they can knock the doors of the Supreme Court of India through Article 136. And here you should also know, can all the civil and criminal cases go before the Supreme Court of India? Each and every civil case and a criminal case, can it go before the Supreme Court of India? No. Only those civil cases which involve the interpretation of the provisions of the Indian Constitution, they are eligible to go before the Supreme Court of India. Similarly, not all the criminal cases can go before the Supreme Court of India. Only those criminal cases where the penalty is a death penalty, where the imprisonment is more than 7 years of imprisonment. Such cases are eligible to go before the Supreme Court of India. In all other cases which are otherwise not eligible to go before the Supreme Court of India, if injustice is done to the citizen of this country, what is the remedy available? Maybe in the Sessions Court at the district level, maybe at the level of High Court, if a citizen feels that injustice is done to them, what is the remedy available? For example, now we have Nirbhaya legislation, that is the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013. And this legislation says that in the event of gang rape, leading to the death of the victim, the maximum punishment which could be given is death penalty. Death penalty. Assume that the lower court, that is the Sessions Court is the highest criminal court at the district level. In the Sessions Court, has given the death penalty and it was appealed in the High Court and the High Court has reversed the judgment. That means it has said the convicts as innocent. So in this particular case where the Sessions Court has given death penalty, the High Court has reversed the death penalty, this case can't go before the Supreme Court of India according to the existing rules. Then don't you think that the parents of that girl may feel that injustice is done to them? Because in the lower court has given death penalty to the offenders, but the High Court has reversed the judgment. So death penalty is taken away. But all such cases cannot go before the Supreme Court of India. Now if the parents of the girl feel that the justice is not done to them. What is the remedy available? The remedy is available under Article 136. So even such cases which otherwise cannot go before the Supreme Court of India can go before the Supreme Court of India under Article 136, called a special leave petition. Special leave means a petition filed before the Supreme Court of India asking the special permission of Supreme Court to admit the cases. So the Supreme Court of India, on its discretion, if it feels that the case involves important interpretation of the provisions of the Indian Constitution, it can admit the case. It is the discretion of the Supreme Court. The petitioner cannot ask it as a matter of right. So that's why we say that special leave petitions under Article 136 is an overriding power of the Indian Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court can take before itself any case, irrespective of eligibility, can take any case before itself, decided by any court, anywhere in the country. Similarly, the Supreme Court can take before itself any case decided by any tribunal anywhere in the country. So it is because of Article 136, the matters are going to the Supreme Court of India. Assume that a tribunal is constituted for resolving an interstate river water dispute. The tribunal has given the award, but it is not acceptable to the states. Now the states can take this matter before the Supreme Court under Article 136. So that's how the matters are reaching the Supreme Court of India. Otherwise, Article 262 very clearly says the interstate river water disputes should end at the stage of tribunal award. They should not go before the Supreme Court. But we have another provision in the Indian Constitution in the form of Article 136, which allows the cases decided by the tribunals to go before the Supreme Court of India. So that's how the cases reach the Supreme Court of India. But Article 262 spirit is political solution. What is political solution? The tribunal deciding the case. And why this was provided for? So the makers of the Indian Constitution, they felt that if the matter is left to the courts, there may be inordinate delay, excessive delay in deciding the disputes. So it is better to refer it to the tribunal where there are experts as well, and where the central and the state governments can have their representatives in the tribunal, and it may be a better way of dealing the disputes. So that's why it was provided for. The political solution is provided for under Article 262 in the form of tribunals. Ideally, the cases should not go before Supreme Court, but they are reaching Supreme Court because of Article 136. So this is how the interstate river water disputes are resolved in India and in America. Then, in 1983, the Union government came up with something called National Water Resources Council. Who is the chairman of National Water Resources Council? So this was a question in the UPSC prelims exam. The chairman of National Water Resources Council. Prime Minister is the chairman of National Water Resources Council. So it has held its first meeting, though National Water Resources Council was formed in 1983. It has met for the first time in 1985. So I am trying to say that in addition to the tribunal, this is one more platform where interstate river water disputes could be discussed and resolved. National Water Resources Council, headed by Prime Minister of India, can act as a platform for resolving the interstate river water disputes. In addition to that, we have Article 263. What is Article 263? Interstate Council. Interstate Council. So, Interstate Council is a platform where the central government and the state governments can talk to each other and resolve the disputes. So, these are the existing mechanisms available under the Indian Constitution to resolve the interstate river water dispute. So, see the question. Is it because of structural inadequacy? It's not because of structural inadequacy. The Indian Constitution contains adequate provisions to deal with interstate river water disputes. The Constitution itself directly contains provisions. In addition to this, we have even the legislation, Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956, providing for tribunal. We have National Water Resources Council. We have Interstate Council. So we have several mechanisms available for resolving the interstate river water disputes. So, it is not because of structural inadequacy, as at least with respect to the provisions of the Indian Constitution. And what do you mean by procedural inadequacy? Procedural inadequacy in the sense, when the existing mechanisms are being utilized, if there is no cooperation from the state governments, nothing can be done. So if the state governments cooperate to resolve the interstate river water disputes, give and take policy, the matters could be resolved. Otherwise, it cannot be. So we can say it is more because of procedural inadequacy. Procedural inadequacy. Then this is one part of our discussion. Then see the statement. Constitutional mechanisms to resolve interstate river water disputes have failed to address and solve the problems. And as I told you, I referred to Kaveri River Water Dispute. The tribunal was appointed in 1986. It gave the award in 2006. It took 20 years, 1986 to 96, 96 to 2006. Even by 2016, the matter is not yet resolved. 30 years. 30 years is pretty long. Then why there is a delay? This is the next question to be answered. Why the interstate river water disputes are not being resolved within the reasonable time? So for that, we have several reasons. So a delay in resolving the interstate river water disputes may occur at three stages. A delay with respect to resolving the interstate river water dispute can occur at three stages. One, before constituting the tribunal itself. Before constituting the tribunal. Second one, after the tribunal is constituted. Third one, after the tribunal gave the award. For example, if you read the provisions of the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956, what are the different steps involved in resolving the interstate river water disputes? The first step is political negotiations. Even before an interstate river water dispute is referred to the tribunal, the first requirement, what has to be done is, the concerned states has to talk to each other and the union government will provide the leadership. If political negotiations fail, one of the states can make a request to the union government to constitute a tribunal. But the problem in the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 is, there is no time limit prescribed within which the political negotiations have to be concluded. Then for how long there should be political negotiations? 3 years? 5 years? 10 years? This is the first problem. Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 says that political negotiations have to be tried. If political negotiations fail, then the matter should be referred to the union government for constituting a tribunal. But here the problem is, there is no time limit prescribed for concluding the political negotiations. So the political negotiations itself may take several years. So here a delay may occur. That's why here for this there was a recommendation made by first ARC. What is first ARC? First Administrative Reforms Commission. It was appointed in 1967. First ARC. And around in 2004-05 we had a second ARC. Second Administrative Reforms Commission. Second Administrative Reforms Commission was headed by Veerappa Moily. First ARC was headed by initially Morarji Desai, subsequently Hanumanthaiah. So this first ARC has made a recommendation. There should be a time limit. There should be a time limit for concluding political negotiations. First Administrative Reforms Commission has recommended political negotiations have to be concluded for 3 years. Within 3 years, if the political negotiations are not concluded, then the matter has to be referred to the union government for constituting a tribunal. Right? So the delay in resolving the interstate river water dispute occurs, but the first reason is no time limit prescribed for concluding the political negotiations. Assume that political negotiations have failed and one of the states has made a request to the union government to constitute a tribunal. Again, there is no time limit. Within what time the union government has to constitute tribunal once the matter is referred to the union government? Here the union government has got absolute discretion. The union government is not compelled to constitute a tribunal within a reasonable time. If the union government feels that the political negotiations are not adequately tried, it can indefinitely delay constituting a tribunal. In other words, a delay can occur because of the discretion of the union government. So the union there is no time limit within which the union government has to constitute tribunal once the matter is referred to the union government. So the union government can take its own lengthy time. And in addition to this, assume that if none of the states make a request to the union government, can the union government constitute a tribunal on its own sumo motu? For example, With respect to river Kaveri, there was dispute between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu for a very long time, and none of the states referred the matter to the Indian government. Can the Indian government constitute a tribunal sumoto on its own? It cannot. This is the third problem. One is, there is a delay because there is no time limit prescribed for political negotiations. Second reason, there is a delay because even after one of the states make a request to the Indian government, there is no time limit within which the Indian government has to constitute a tribunal. Right? Assume that political negotiations are failed, the matter is referred to the Indian government, the Indian government has constituted a tribunal. Once the tribunal is constituted, again there is a problem. What is the problem? The Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 does not prescribe the time limit within which the tribunal has to give the order. And many a time the tribunals are an average to 10 years for giving the order. Why the tribunals are taking pretty long time? The third problem is, there is no time limit prescribed for the tribunal to give its award. So they take something like 10 years time. This is the third problem with the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. And why the tribunals are taking pretty long time? What could be the reason? See, for the tribunal to give its award, it needs the data relating to the flow of water in the river. And this data is available to the state governments. And the states are not willing to cooperate with the tribunal. The Union government cannot compel the states. The Union government doesn't have any authority of its own to collect the data relating to water flow. This is the problem. So a delay can occur even after the tribunal is constituted because of the non-cooperation of the state governments. The Union government cannot compel the states to cooperate, and the Union government doesn't have its own authority. The Union government doesn't have its own authority to collect the data relating to flow of water in the river. Right? Fourth. So delay can occur for this fourth reason. Then assume that the tribunal has completed its job and the tribunal has given the award. According to the spirit of Article 262, the award shall be final and binding. The states have to implement the award given by the tribunal. But the states don't feel comfortable in implementing the award of the tribunal. For example, take even the state of Andhra Pradesh with respect to Krishna River water disputes. We had initially the first tribunal headed by Bachawal. The second one was headed by Brijesh Kumar Tribunal. So the award given by the tribunal was not acceptable to the state of Andhra Pradesh. So the state of Andhra Pradesh filed a special petition before the Supreme Court of India. That means, even after the award is given by the tribunal, the states don't feel comfortable in implementing the award of the tribunal. They are taking the matter further to the Supreme Court of India. So this is another reason why a delay will occur. And once the matter reaches to the Supreme Court of India, the Supreme Court of India is an overburdened institution. It takes its own time to resolve the issue. For example, you might be aware of S.R. Bommai case. In 1989, S.R. Bommai was the Chief Minister of Karnataka. He was enjoying absolute majority in the State Legislative Assembly. Just because few legislators have defected from his party to other party, the governor has sent a report to the President, S.R. Bommai doesn't enjoy majority in the lower house. Without giving opportunity to S.R. Bommai to prove the majority in the floor of house, S.R. Bommai came forward to prove his majority in the Legislative Assembly, but opportunity is not given. President rule is imposed and S.R. Bommai government was dismissed. This matter went to the Supreme Court and it was finally decided in December 1993. How many years it took? Supreme Court took more than 4 years. 89, the petition is filed. 90, 91, 92, 93. This is the reason. So once the matter is referred to the Supreme Court, again there is a delay. So these are the reasons why there is inordinate delay, excessive delay in resolving the interstate river water disputes. Here we can say one thing. With respect to the provisions of the Indian Constitution, there is no inadequacy.
Sir, why there was so much delay of 4 years in the Supreme Court?
Maybe, for example, if you make a comparison between Indian Supreme Court and American Supreme Court, the American Supreme Court doesn't decide civil cases and criminal cases. It decides only the disputes between the central government and the states. It's purely a federal court. But in India, that is not the case. Indian Supreme Court enforces fundamental rights. Indian Supreme Court resolves the disputes between the state and center. In addition to this, it will decide every case. Civil cases, criminal cases, marriage, divorce, labor cases. Because of the 736 only, special petition. The Supreme Court took to itself a lot of burden. So everything under the sky will come under the jurisdiction of the Indian Supreme Court. But a federal court has to have the primary function of resolving the dispute between the center and the states. But Indian Supreme Court did not stick to this, like the American Supreme Court. The American Supreme Court does not decide civil and criminal cases. It will decide only the dispute between the federal government and the state government. And as a result, the burden on the American Supreme Court is less. It will be able to decide the cases with much more speed. But in India, all categories of the cases, they go before the Supreme Court. And as a result, the time available to the Supreme Court will be not adequate. Number of judges are not adequate in proportion to the workload. And as a result, there is a delay. So here we can say two things. There was no structural inadequacy with respect to the provisions of the Indian Constitution. But definitely there was a structural inadequacy with respect to the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. The Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 has several problems. What are the several problems? I told you. There was no time limit prescribed for political negotiations. There is no time limit prescribed within what time the Union government has to constitute a tribunal. There is no time limit within which the tribunal has to give the award. And in addition to that, the tribunal award is not binding on the state government. The matters are taken to the Supreme Court. So these are the problems with the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. We had a problem with respect to Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. This legislation is not foolproof. There are several gaps in the existing legislation, Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. And in addition to that, once the tribunal gives the award, there is no machinery to enforce the award given by the tribunal, to implement the award given by the tribunal. That's one more lacking. And that's why Sarkaria Commission. So you know that the Sarkaria Commission is the first commission in Central State Relations, appointed in 1983, gave the report in 1987. So Sarkaria Commission made several recommendations for addressing the problems in the existing Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. What is the first problem? I told you that there is no time limit prescribed for political negotiations. For that, first IRC has given the solution. What is the recommendation of first IRC? First Administrative Reform Commission recommended that political negotiations have to be concluded within 3 years. If political negotiations fail, then the tribunal has to be constituted by the Union government if one of the states make a request. So there was a solution for that first problem. What is the second problem? One of the states make a request to the Union government, there is no time limit prescribed within which the Union government has to constitute a tribunal. But Sarkari Commission gave a recommendation. If one of the states make a request to the Union government has to constitute a tribunal within 1 year. It cannot take indefinite time. And the other problem I told you, if none of the states make a request to the Union government, can the Union government constitute a tribunal tomorrow? It cannot. But Sarkari Commission gave a recommendation. In a situation where none of the states make request to the Union government shall be able to constitute a tribunal sumoto on its own. So this is the second solution recommended by Sarkari Commission. In addition to that, the other problem which I told you is once the tribunal is constituted, there is no time limit prescribed within what time the tribunal has to give award. Sarkari Commission said that once a tribunal is constituted, the tribunal has to give its award within 5 years. For compelling reasons, this time limit can be extended. That is the second solution. That was the next solution provided by Sarkari Commission. In addition to this, a judgment given by the Supreme Court of India is binding on the central and the state government. But the Sarkari Commission said that an award given by the tribunal should have the same force, same validity, like the order made by the Supreme Court of India. If that is guaranteed, then the award of the tribunal may be binding on the state government. So that's the idea. But even then it was a problematic thing. As of now, under Article 141 of the Indian Constitution, under Article 141 of the Indian Constitution, an order given by the Supreme Court of India is binding on the central government and the state government. But the same validity is not there for the award of the tribunal. So Sarkaria Commission recommended amend the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956, saying that the award of the tribunal should have the same force, same validity, like the order made by the Supreme Court of India. In addition to this, I told you that the states are not cooperating with the tribunal. For that, Sarkari Commission recommended give powers of court to the tribunal, powers of civil court. So the civil court, they have powers to ask for information from the government, state government, and it is compulsory for the state governments to provide the information. Give such powers to the tribunal. So the tribunal should be given the powers of a civil court under which the tribunal can ask for information from the state governments, and the state governments are bound to give that information. In addition to that, in 1985, I told you that National Water Resources Council, National Water Resources Council has met for the first time. In the first meeting, it took a decision. The decision is, we are facing the problem of non-cooperation from the state government. They are not sharing the data relating to the flow of water. Why to depend on the state governments? Let the union government create an agency at the union level to collect the data relating to water flow in the states. That was recommended by this National Water Resources Council. In 1985, in the first meeting, National Water Resources Council has recommended creating a data and information system at the union level to collect the data relating to water flow, so that we can reduce the dependence on the state governments. So these were the recommendations made by Sarkariya Commission. Based on the recommendations of the Sarkariya Commission, in 2002, the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 was amended. Amendment means changing the law. And before 2002, it was done in 1980. I told you that there were several problems with the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. And these problems were addressed through the changes made to this law in 1980 and in 2002. In 1980, Section 6A was inserted in the law. You don't need to remember this section. This is Section 6A, says, I told you. Once the tribunal has done its job, once the tribunal gave the award, there is no machinery to enforce the award of the tribunal, to implement the award of the tribunal. The amendment which was done in 1980 has provided for creating such an authority. The amendment which was done to the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 in 1980 has empowered the union government to create an authority for implementing the award of the tribunal. So that's one amendment which was done in 1980. Then in 2002, some more amendments were done. Some more amendments here I told you. Till 2002, is there a time limit for the union government to constitute a tribunal once the matter is referred to it? Sarkari Commission said it is within 1 year you should constitute the tribunal, but the law was saying only in 2002. So till 2002, the union government took its own time. But in 2002, the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 was amended, making it mandatory, compulsory for the union government to constitute a tribunal within 1 year once the matter is referred to the union government by one of the states. Then in addition to that, I told you, once the tribunal is constituted, there is no time limit within which the tribunal has to give the award. What Sarkari Commission has recommended? Within 5 years. But the amendment which was done in 2002 said that once the tribunal is constituted, the tribunal has to give award within 3 years. So time limit is prescribed for the tribunal to give the award in the 2002 amendment. If there is any compelling reason, any genuine reason why the tribunal cannot give the award within 3 years, 2 more years extension could be given. So this is the second amendment which was done in 2002. In the third amendment, I told you, the award given by the tribunal doesn't have the force of the order of the Supreme Court of India. The award given by the tribunal doesn't have the same validity like the order given by the Supreme Court of India. So in 2002, the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 was amended, saying that the award given by the tribunal should have the same force, same validity like the order given by the Supreme Court of India, which means the states cannot say no for implementing the award of the tribunal. So this was what is inserted in 2002. The award of the tribunal shall have the same force and validity like the order given by the Supreme Court of India. Despite this amendment, the states continue to not to bother or care about the awards of the tribunal. They are taking the matter to the Supreme Court. As long as Article 136 is allowed to continue in the Constitution, matters can be taken to the Supreme Court of India, because Article 136 allows. So these were the amendments which were done. Then what are the problems which continue? There were problems, some of them were rectified under the 2002 amendment and 1980 amendment. What are the problems which were resolved by now? Initially, there was no machinery to enforce the award of the tribunal. In 1980, the law is amended and the Indian government is empowered to create an authority for enforcing the award of the tribunal. Then there was one more problem. The Indian government was not bound to constitute a tribunal within a definite time period. But 2002 amendment said, once the matter is referred to the Indian government, tribunal has to be constituted within 1 year. And once the tribunal is constituted, there is no time limit before. But in 2002, it was said that the tribunal has to give the award within 3 years. If there is any compelling reason, another 2 years extension could be given. And the order of the award of the tribunal should have the same force like the order given by the Supreme Court. So these were some of the corrections which were done. But two problems continue even today. What are those two problems? First Administrative Reforms Commission recommended a time limit for concluding the political negotiations. It said only 3 years. But even by today, there was no such provision. Under the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956, which was amended in 1980 and in 2002, there was silence on this issue. This 1956 legislation does not prescribe the time limit within which the political negotiations have to be concluded. So it continues to be a problem. In addition to that, I told you that if none of the states make a request to the Union government, can the Union government constitute a tribunal on its own? No. But what Sarkari Commission has recommended? Give the powers to the Union government to constitute a tribunal sumo to. But this amendment, this recommendation was not implemented. And in the amendment done in 2000. So these are the reasons why there is a delay in resolving the interstate river water disputes. Right? Able to get up. Able to appreciate? Then what is the way forward? What are the recommendations made by Tunchi Commission? What are the recommendations made by Tunchi Commission? Second year. Second Administrative Reforms Commission. See, are you aware of Ramaswamy Iyer? Ramaswamy Iyer? Pauline Harima? So this man was the secretary to the Ministry of Water Resources in the Union government before. He was now retired. A senior IAS officer who served as the secretary to the Ministry of Water Resources in the Union government. And he is an expert on the subject of water. And this man writes periodical articles in Hindu. So this man has given one recommendation which was accepted by the Punchi Commission. As of now, is the tribunal permanent body constituted under the Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956 or is it temporary? It is temporary. Why is it temporary? Once the matter is referred to a tribunal, once the award is given by the tribunal, there the matter ends. The tribunal will be dissolved. As of now, the Interstate River Water Disputes Tribunals constituted under the 1956 law, they are not permanent, they are temporary. Once their job gets over, they are dissolved. But Ramaswamy Iyer says that let there be a permanent Interstate River Water Disputes Tribunal with multiple benches. Why? Because the states have to make a request to the Union government. The Union government has to talk to the Chief Justice of India. The Chief Justice of India has to constitute a tribunal every time when there is an issue. Instead of that, if there is a permanent tribunal, matters will be much more easy. So Ramaswamy Iyer and Punchi Commission has recommended let there be a permanent Interstate River Water Disputes Tribunal with multiple benches so that all the regions, north, south, east, west, central, northeast, they can refer the cases to the bench of the Interstate River Water Disputes Tribunal. Then Pauline Harima, who was an expert on the constitutional issues, a constitutional expert, he says that why try political negotiations? What we are doing? We are trying political negotiations. If they fail, we are referring the matter to the tribunal. And after the tribunal gives the award, it is not acceptable to the states. Again, we are going to the Supreme Court of it. And in the process, we are taking something like 20 to 30 years. Why wasting the time trying political negotiations, referring the matter to the tribunal? Because anyhow, the states are not happy with what the tribunal says. The states are not happy even with respect to what the Supreme Court of India says. Even, for example, take the Cauvery dispute. When the Supreme Court gave an order for implementing, for implementation, Karnataka state government doesn't feel comfortable implementing the order. This is the state of affairs with respect to an order given by the Supreme Court of India, the highest court. So Fali Nariman says, why political solution? Let's go for judicial solution. Let the matter be referred straight away to the Indian Supreme so that we can cut down the delay. Political negotiations say 8 years, tribunal taking another 10 years, 20 years is the time. So you can, if you refer the matter straight away to the Supreme Court, you can cut down the delay. This is what American Constitution is provided for. But if you see the American Constitution experience, the American Constitution came into implementation in September 1789, and we are in 2017, almost 227 years. The American Constitution is under implementation for the last 227 years. The American Supreme Court, based on its experience, now says political solution is a better solution rather than judicial solution. Why? The American Constitution provided for judicial solution, but Indian Constitution provided for political solution. But the working of the American Constitution, the experience is political solution is a better solution rather than judicial solution. Why political solution is a better solution? Because here all the representatives of the political parties, they can participate in political negotiations and can arrive at a solution. So if you have greater accommodation, statesmanship qualities, give and take, the matters can be resolved. Without involving the contending partners, is it possible to resolve a dispute? Assume that the American Supreme Court will finally decide the case. If it is not acceptable to the states and if the states are not willing to implement the decision of the American Supreme Court, this will create huge problems. That's what the American Supreme Court said. The American Supreme Court, based on its experience of resolving the interstate river water disputes, said it is far better for the American Parliament to decide the procedures to be followed for resolving the interstate river water disputes. Judicial solution may not be viable, may not be practical. So the Americans are running towards political solution, but Indians are running towards judicial solution. Indian Constitution did provide for political solution, but we are not happy with political negotiations. We are not willing to resolve the issue through political negotiations. We are not happy with the award of the tribunal. We are happy with only the judgment of the Indian Supreme Court. That means, though Indian Constitution provided for political solution, we are running for judicial solution. So Fali Nariman says, if every matter is taken to the Supreme Court of India with respect to interstate river water disputes, then why political negotiations? Why the tribunal? Let the matter be straight away referred to the Supreme Court. Let the Supreme Court take 4 to 5 years. At least if it decides in 5 years, that is far better than waiting for 20 to 30 years. But here there is a problem. If you want to go for a judicial solution, you have to take away Article 262. Article 262 plus 1 and 2. Article, what does Article 262 says? Article 262 says that Parliament by law provide for adjudication of interstate river water disputes. Parliament by law has to exclude the jurisdiction of the court with respect to interstate river water disputes. So Article 262 expressly provides for political solution. If we have to implement the recommendation of Fali Nariman, from the Indian Constitution we have to delete one article. That is Article 262. We don't know whether the Supreme Court will allow it or not. That's one problem with the recommendation of Fali Nariman. Otherwise, Fali Nariman recommendation is sensible in the sense we can cut down the delay. Political negotiations, then tribunal, and then not accessing the award of the tribunal, then going to the Supreme Court. Instead of all these things, if the matter is straight away referred to the Supreme Court of India, it may take 4 to 5 years. Once the matter is decided by the Supreme Court, it will be binding on the state concerned. So we can cut down great delay. So these were the recommendations made by Ramaswamy Iyer, Fali Nariman. And it is agreed to by the Commission. The second Commission on Central State Relations is referring to Ramaswamy Iyer and Fali Nariman and says that we are in agreement with the recommendation of Ramaswamy Iyer and Fali Nariman. But second ARC needs a 7th report, Capacity Building for Conflict Resolution. So there is one chapter on interstate river water disputes. The chapter is Chapter 5, Second Administrative Reform Commission, 7th Report, Capacity Building for Conflict Resolution. In that report, Chapter 5 deals with interstate river water disputes. Second ARC says that Indian Constitution has provided for political solution. Let us respect the provisions of the Indian Constitution. But who cares Because as long as Article 136 is available, no state government will care for the award of the tribunal. Either you have to take away Article 136, and if you want to provide for political solution, if the matter has to end with the tribunal, remove Article 136. But do you think that Supreme Court will agree for removing Article 136? It will never. Why? Because Article 136 empowers the Supreme Court of India with special powers. It can take up any case decided by any court anywhere in the country. So this is an overriding power available to the Supreme Court of India. So no institution would love to reduce their authority and power. So if you want to ensure political solution, you need to take away Article 136. But it is not possible. The Supreme Court will not allow that. But second AIC says that as the Indian Constitution under Article 262 has provided for political solution, let's respect Article 262. Let's not take the matter to the Supreme Court of India. But nobody will care for second AIC recommendation, because Article, as long as Article 136 allows the states to take the matter to the Supreme Court, the matters will continue to go to the Supreme Court of India. So that's about interstate pure water disputes. That's about the interstate pure water disputes. This was a general in the last year, 2016. And this was a 12 and a half marker question in 2013. What is the time?
6:34.
So there is a problem. This guy was a newcomer. He is a newcomer. You and that guy were the seniors. He also completed regular question. So actually I wanted to start with the basics on Indian polity. So maybe from next class onwards we have two sessions. One for general essay, one for basics on Indian polity. I want to start with Indian polity basics, then move further into the subject. So is it comfortable for you? I think there will be some difficulty because we don't know what is Article 262, Article 136, what is this special regulation. So that's the problem. We have two groups of people, few are more serious and the few are more. So we will try to resolve it in the course of.